introduction. I mean, as someone famously said in America once, flattery is all right as long as you don't inhale. So, anyway, thanks for all the very kind words. Much appreciated. Thanks so much to Swati and the members of the ASEAN network, all the communities represented here, for your very kind invitation to join you this evening. I feel very honoured and very privileged to be here with you, to participate in this event, commemorating, as we are, the 1991 Paris Peace Accords, and recognising the contribution of so many political and other colleagues in keeping alive not only the flame of peace, but the flames of democracy and human rights that were lit three decades ago. I think Australia can remain pretty proud of the role that we played in bringing peace to Cambodia. No people in the world then cried out more for peace, or more deserved it. With the country ravaged, as you all remember, ravaged for years before by the first the massive US bombing during the Vietnam War, the civil war that followed that, the Khmer Rouge reign of terror, then civil war again following the invasion and installation of Hun Sen's government by Vietnam. These successive onslaughts, and above all the horrific Khmer Rouge genocide, caused the deaths of some 2 million Cambodian men, women and children, and effectively destroyed the lives of a great many more. Every attempt that was made during the 1980s to bring this suffering, terrible misery to an end, failed, essentially as a result of the labyrinth of intractable differences which existed between Cambodia's warring internal parties and factions, between their respective regional backers, and by their big power patrons standing behind them. The United States, as you remember, supported ASEAN and the Cambodian Royalist parties. Russia supported Vietnam, not then a member of ASEAN, and Hun Sen. China supported the communist Khmer Rouge. Nobody would compromise. Nobody could agree on anything. Australia initiated in 1989 the diplomatic strategy that finally worked to unlock the conflict. Essentially by designing, as we did, an unprecedentedly hands-on role for the United Nations in the governing of the country through a transitional period, which gave China a face-saving way of withdrawing its support for the Khmer Rouge without having to directly yield power to Hun Sen or the Royalists and the other countries that were backing them. We did the diplomatic hard yards in translating what at the beginning was just an idea into a workable strategy, particularly with the extraordinary Odyssey conducted by then DFAT Foreign Affairs and Trade Deputy Secretary Mike Costello, who's due to join us, and I hope he will later this evening, an extraordinary diplomatic mission extending to 30 meetings in 13 different countries over 21 days, just 21 days, 30 meetings in 21 countries, testing the viability of our idea. We then did the hard words, in the hard yards, in turning broad concepts into detailed operational plans. And that was the role of the famous Red Book, which many of you in the Cambodian community at least will, I think, widely remember. That we prepared that operational strategy for the very crucial Jakarta meeting in February 1990, which was chaired by my friend, the Indonesian Foreign Minister Ali Alatas, with whom we worked in Australia hand in glove throughout this whole process. And then, of course, there was General John Sanderson's wonderful, impressive leadership of the UNTAC, the UN Transitional Administration Military Mission, during the critical 91 to 93 transition period. And John Sanderson's role was absolutely crucial to its success. The UN peace plan did achieve its principal peacemaking aims. External patrons, above all China with the Khmer Rouge, did withdraw material support from the various political groupings, sucking away the oxygen that had kept the civil war going. The more than 365,000 displaced Cambodians were successfully, and some of you I know in this room were in that number, were successfully repatriated from the Thai border. The Cambodian conflict was removed as a source of regional tension, and it became possible for Vietnam to enter into much more productive relations as members of the wider Southeast Asian community as a result. Cambodia's own reconstruction could at last get to assume its own rightful place in the community of nations. But, a big but. But as I said, when representing Australia as our foreign minister then, at the signing ceremony of the Paris Peace Accords in 1991, peace and freedom are not prizes which once gained can never be lost. They must be won again each day. Their foundations must be sunk deep into the bedrock of political stability, economic prosperity, and above all, the observance of human rights. Sadly, the truth of that observation of mine all those years ago has been borne out repeatedly over the last three decades. We brought peace to Cambodia, with it some overdue national economic development. But as to democracy, as to human rights, the other two core elements of those Paris agreements, the record we all have to acknowledge has been one dismal failure. The rot set in very early. The 1993 election itself was a brilliant success. 90% turnout. It was an incredibly moving experience, one of the most moving of my whole public life, to watch those voters, many of you again here I'm sure were among them, in their family groups, everyone from grannies to tiny babies, lined up for hours at those polling stations right around the country, notwithstanding the ever-present threat of bomb attacks from the Khmer Rouge, knowing the high risk, but with so much joyful confidence in the future. But that election did not result in the widely expected win for Hun Sen and his governing Cambodian People's Party. He refused to accept the result. And the international community, far too meekly, I have to say, in retrospect, and I've been guilty myself about that, allowed him to become joint Prime Minister, even though he hadn't had enough votes to acquire anything like this status. And that election in 1993 was the last fully fair and free election that Cambodia was to hold. Hun Sen has been clever and utterly ruthless. Within a short time, he vanquished his opponents and taken steps to ensure no opposition party could meaningfully contest his leadership. And over the years that have passed, the CPP has, I'm afraid, become synonymous with corruption, evictions, control of the judiciary, political repression, wide-scale arrests and imprisonment, physical threats to those protesting, the loss of human rights, and on occasion, outright murder, including the brazen daylight shooting of Kim Lay, whose death we all still mourn in 2016. Any pretense of commitment to genuine democracy vanished with the arrest and the banning of Kem Sokar in 2017, with the following puppet court banning of the main opposition party, the CNRP, some whose members are represented here today, the reassignment of the CNRP Assembly member seats to government supporters, the continued persecution of Sam Rainsy, and the imminent likely banning now, which I think we have to contemplate, repeating history again before next year's election, of the Candlelight Party he founded. That is now clearly on the cards. If Cambodia is to have the democratic, rights-respecting future it so obviously needs and its people so obviously deserve, I believe the greatest hope lies with Cambodia's own people. Backed up with support and pressure, not so much from the UN and other big multilateral organisations, which have largely gone missing, I'm afraid, since the early 1990s, but from individual countries with political leaders genuinely committed to human rights and democracy, and who are capable still of exercising some influence. Cambodia's people, both at home and abroad, including the diaspora, so well represented here this evening in Australia, have shown extraordinary courage, extraordinary resilience in the face of adversity, and shown that whenever they had the chance, that the Cambodian people, above all, want the restoration of peace and governance. With a median age in the country of 25, its population, the youngest, I'm told, of any Southeast Asian country, Cambodia manifestly has wonderful potential. And younger generation leaders have continued to struggle against almost impossible odds to keep the flames of justice alight. The story of Cambodia's many brave human rights defenders has been superbly told by Sue Coffey with us here this evening in her book Seeking Justice in Cambodia. It's really important that this story continue to be told and that its message of hope gets through to the next generation. Beyond their own resources and commitment, what the Cambodian people really need is external support, not just in the form of sympathetic resolutions from multilateral forums, and not just the moral support, as important as that is and as vividly on display as it is here tonight from other regional diaspora communities hosting this evening's event. What they need also is hard, practical measures from individual countries, like Australia, that can put real pressure on Hun Sen and those around him to modify their behaviour. This means, in particular, in the context of the next scheduled general election in 2023, pressure to reverse the ban on the CNRP and its leaders, to not touch the Candlelight Party, and to enable the genuine exercise of civil and political rights right across the whole community. Targeted individual sanctions against key regime members and their families, basically asset freezes and other financial restrictions and visa bans, are probably the most useful forms of such pressure. And after dragging our feet for years, Australia, with the passage of our own Magnitsky Act, so-called recently, has made easier the application of such sanctions in these kinds of human rights cases. So Australia has been a world leader in the past in supporting the Cambodian people in their yearning for life and for liberty. With their basic rights and freedoms now more imperiled than they have been since the end of the Khmer Rouge genocide, it really is time for our voice, along with voices from many other countries, to be once again very strongly heard. I've got great confidence that with the presence among us here this evening of so many of our political leaders in this country committed to this cause, that will matter. But again, I say, at the end of the day, it's the voice of the Cambodian people, both at home and abroad, your voice, that will matter most. So I also have enormous confidence that with the continuing commitment of so many Cambodians, including all those participating in this event, there will prevail that strong majority will for decency and for dignity, the genuine democracy and genuine respect for human rights that so obviously exists, and that Canberra wanted it to be when we finally put to rest 30 years ago the ravages of genocide and civil war. But thank you all for coming together. Thank you for the opportunity to celebrate with you that achievement. And thank you for the opportunity of being able to remind you of just how much remains to be done, but how competent and willing and capable so many of you here tonight are to contribute to the ongoing process. Thank you.
បាទបងប្អូនមិនតាន់បាន Subscribe នៅ Channel KKCC TV នេះសូមមេត្តាជួយចុចកណ្ដឹងហើយជួយ Like ជួយ Share បន្តទៅកាន់ប្រិយមិត្តរបស់យើងឲ្យបានគ្រប់គ្រប់គ្នាផងសូមអរគុណ